Hey everyone, CyVenom here, and I'm back with another episode. Today, let's take it back to the basics and talk about why you should care about Kubernetes today. Now, Kubernetes is one of the most popular ways to run containers at scale, and comes with a host of complexities. In this video, I want to break down Kubernetes into some of the key things that it does really well. Now, no conversation about Kubernetes can begin without an understanding of containers. But I'll keep it short because I've talked about it in depth before, but I've sketched it out up here already. Essentially, containers enable you to share the resources of the infrastructure that it's running on. Containers package up your application and its dependencies. And the key way that it's different from something like virtual machines powered by hypervisors is that that allocation, that sharing happens at the OS level. This means that containers can start up faster, they're more lightweight, and more, maybe most importantly, developers love containers. They've solved the age-old problem of, well, it works fine on my computer. And I think this is one of standardization. Developers are confident knowing that they can package up their applications and its dependencies in a lightweight container, and that really promotes agile development and iterative workflows. And so that's why we use containers today, and that's why they're so popular. But let's shift that conversation and talk a little bit about containers in the Kubernetes context. Very simply, let's just say, even before Kubernetes, we've got a few containers running on our local machine. And when we talk about containers many times, we talk about microservices. And that's because containers are really great at running microservices. I think a long time ago, some smart people figured out that it makes more sense to decouple logic instead of sticking it all into one massive monolith. And so let's say we've got these three containers running on our local machine, a front end, a back end that powers that front end, and a data tier that enables us to store things like user sessions, that kind of thing. And things are running great on our local machine, but we need to take this to scale. So we spin up some EC2 machines, some instances, basically some compute on AWS, and we've got the containers running. And the first challenge I'm going to run into when I'm doing this, something called scheduling. It's figuring out where to run these containers in the most effective way, and that's something that Kubernetes does really well. Kubernetes is powered by config, so let's see exactly how we would do that if we have this Kubernetes cluster set up. So let's say that we want two copies of the front end. Say we want three copies of the back end application. And then for the data, we've got two copies. Kubernetes is powered by something called a control loop. So it's always checking to make sure the config matches the state of the world. That's obviously not the case right now. So the first thing it's going to do is spin up those containers. So we needed two of these, two of the data containers, and three of the backend. One of the things to think about here is that that I want to point out, these are actually pods in the context of Kubernetes. A pod is just one or more containers. It's a logical grouping. Kubernetes likes working with pods. In today's example, each pod is one container. So essentially, we've talked about this is how we maybe deploy this. But one of the cool things about Kubernetes I want to talk about next is that it's self-healing. Let's say the front end crashes, you know, segment fault, something happens, it goes down. That control loop, always running, kicks in and says, oh, we need another copy of the front end. And so it'll self-heal and make sure that config is hit. But let's talk about scaling. Now, I can manually bump this number up and Kubernetes will handle it for me, but auto-scaling is also critical here. Now, out of the box, Kubernetes supports horizontal pod auto-scaling. Essentially, what that means is if for this backend, I want the CPU target to be 50%. In addition, I want to tell Kubernetes that you can scale this all the way up to, say, 7 pods. So if that CPU target of the running containers pods exceeds 50%, it's going to start adding more pods to keep that target at 50. It's one of the really cool things about Kubernetes out of the box is horizontal pod auto-scaling, also vertical pod auto-scaling, which increases the size, the allocations for the pods themselves. There's also cluster auto-scaling, which can increase the number of nodes to meet requirements. And by the way, there's a cool project here called Carpenter. That's Carpenter with a K. That's great for when you're running Kubernetes in AWS using something like EKS, Elastic Kubernetes Service, which makes it really effective to take advantage of some of the key features in AWS when it comes to scaling up a cluster. We'll talk about that in a minute, how Kubernetes is open source, pluggable, and extensible. So we've talked about self-healing. We've talked about auto-scaling. One of the things we've glossed over is the networking of this all. These are all running on different nodes. They each have different IP addresses that might be changing. How, as developers, can we tell these containers how to talk to one another? It's a really cool concept. Kubernetes abstracts this into something called a service. Essentially, what you can do is give it a selector and say, look, pick all the pods with the name FE, and then we're going to call the service very simply. Let's just call it FE. We'll do the same thing for the backend. And so in our architecture, let's say that the backend needs to talk to the data tier, right? So when we look at something like that, we don't want to track all of the individual IP addresses that might be changing. We want to be a little smarter with this. We want something like service discovery, and this is something that Kubernetes does great out of the box. So let's say the backend wants to talk to data, and so Kubernetes is going to basically let you do http://data, and that'll resolve to one of these two pods. And it does so because out of the box, it also has load balancing. So you create the service, and now your applications can talk to each other very simply just using that service name. Now, it's a little bit of a simplification, but that's essentially how networking works within Kubernetes. Now, we talked about scaling, the self-healing, the networking. There's a number of things I can't cover in this video just because of the time, things like secrets management and automatic rollouts. Let's say you had a new version you wanted to roll out. But I want to skip those, and maybe let's talk really quickly about the fact that Kubernetes is open source, pluggable, and extensible. Now, there's a lot of things that Kubernetes does well out of the box. There's also certain things that Kubernetes won't do. And so there's a great open source community out there that's developing projects to augment, provide alternatives to current Kubernetes capabilities. We talked about one already, Carpenter, which is a great way to do cluster autoscaling as an alternative to the one already within Kubernetes, which is great for when you're running something like EKS, Elastic Kubernetes Service, within AWS. Now, today we talked about why Kubernetes is so popular. You might be wondering, why would you want to run Kubernetes in a managed context using something like Elastic Kubernetes Service on AWS? And while Kubernetes is great and all these capabilities are available in kind of vanilla Kubernetes, when running in a cloud service provider, developers and operators expect some of the heavy lift to be handled for them. Kubernetes, unfortunately, does have a little bit of a heavy lift. And that's exactly where managed Kubernetes services come in, like EKS. I want to talk about that in a future video. Now, I hope this overview was helpful. If you have any questions, be sure to drop a like and a comment below, and stay tuned for more videos like this in the future. Thank you.